This field is lacking pretty much any therapy. There's no therapy for this disease.
Welcome to Arthritis Now. Today we're talking to Dr. Denis Evseenko of the University of Southern California. He's Associate Professor of Orthopedic Surgery, Regenerative Medicine, and Stem Cell Research. Today we're learning about osteoarthritis and a novel approach using stem cells to create a therapy that may slow or even reverse the damage in our joints due to injury and aging. Thank you so much for joining us today. First of all, I want to ask you, when did you receive a grant from the ANRF and what did it do for your research?
Well, I think the first grant, I received it in 2013. It was at the time when I was a junior faculty at UCLA. And as you know, the funding climate for junior faculty is extremely challenging. This grant helped me to actually build my laboratory and helped me to define some critical directions for our research. This grant helped me to obtain the funding from California Institute of Regenerative Medicine, and it was a $1.3 million grant that we received last year.
Wow, congratulations. That's really great for your work. And so basically without the start with the ANRF, it would have been very difficult to secure that kind of funding then, you're saying?
Yeah, well, it's absolutely, because even this other foundations at the moment, competition is very, very significant, and success rate is 5 to 10% at the most. So you can imagine what people experience when they try to secure this first funding, and it was very important for me. And in this case, we had a very clear endpoint. It's basically helping people with degenerative joint disease and osteoarthritis. And it was very clear right from the beginning that this field is lacking pretty much any therapy. There's no therapy for this disease. It's only pain control, and it's just symptomatic therapy, or it's total joint replacement. This challenge is a great motivation, and that's what I experienced. I think a clear objective and a significant practical need for this innovation, that was, I think, two things that were driving me.
Yeah, as someone with RA, rheumatoid arthritis, and other forms of autoimmune arthritis, it's really interesting for me to think about osteoarthritis, because I do have treatment options, at least. They may not work for everybody, but at least there are things I can try. Unlike with osteoarthritis, which is essentially what you're saying, is there's only Band-Aids available, correct? So the you're looking at anti-inflammatories and pain management, like you said, but nothing to treat that underlying disease.
Right. Well, even as you mentioned, anti-inflammatory therapy, sometimes it's not even applicable, because in some patients, there's no significant signs of inflammation. It's very different from rheumatoid arthritis. It's more degenerative disease, and degeneration is not necessarily related to inflammation. We have limited understanding of this disease, and we need to understand biology of it and pathophysiology of it first to find some treatments. And it's also very clear that as soon as osteoarthritis is advanced, it's a serious grade of cartilage loss. It's probably too late to apply any of these new therapies or innovations, because it's going to be extremely difficult to regrow it. So I think it's quite clear that the main goal is actually to prevent this degenerative process and to apply these therapies as early as possible.
Now I have a question. So we're talking about osteoarthritis. It's typically something that is associated with the older population. But, as I meet people within the arthritis community, there's plenty of people with early onset osteoarthritis. Now, when you're looking at your research, are you focusing it on any one age group? Will that make it easier to identify something and maybe learn about the other age groups? Or will that come into play at all?
Well, I think it's a good question. Quite a few patients who experience significant symptoms of osteoarthritis very early. And I think one of these groups is certainly professional athletes or people who experienced some major post-traumatic syndromes. For example, anterior cruciate ligament tear or some other knee injuries, such as problems with meniscus. When they're young, usually the symptoms go away, but in 10 years, most of them will experience and develop osteoarthritis. So it's quite a significant group of people, and I think there's one advantage here. At least we know that they are at very high risk of osteoarthritis, because many other people, they don't have family history, they don't have any genetic predisposition, they didn't have any trauma. When they come, they have their disease actually diagnosed. It's sometimes too late for any intervention, and that's why the only one options that they have available is total joint replacement.
You know, I haven't thought about this before when studying osteoarthritis, but in a way you have, you know, a really good sort of control group to look at early on, you know, before they've maybe developed the disease. When you're looking at some of these professional athletes, like you said, or high-end endurance athletes with injuries. So, you know this is a high risk group. So does that allow you to maybe research them differently and proclivities to diseases that they may develop?
I think at the moment we are in the process of designing a large animal trial for one of the new therapies that we developed. And the way it works, it's actually mimicking this post-traumatic situation and degeneration. So I think if we are successful, we plan to actually go into clinical trial in 2-3 years. A lot of data now clearly showing us from small animal models that this drug that we developed has a very unusual protective effect in a degenerative disease. Going back to your question, I think that the first clinical trial that we will design will be focused on this high-risk group of young patients in a clearly defined post-traumatic sort of osteoarthritis. I think the reason why we'll do it is because I think this will be much more uniformed. Because if you look at much older patients, so their osteoarthritis may result from completely different reasons. So it's very difficult to actually create a group of people that have uniform symptoms and uniform manifestations of structural degeneration. We strongly believe that the younger the patient is, so the higher chances for repair and regeneration we have here. And we have the same data from our animal studies that certainly young joints respond to this stimulatory treatments way better than age joints. And this is, as you understand, it's a common sense, right? I think the younger you are, more regenerative your tissues are.
May I ask what the efficacy is of the drug that you're looking at or where it is currently with research?
What we see now is it slows down degeneration of articular cartilage. And the effects are striking. And what we see in the drug-treated groups, that cartilage basically stays normal, even though the joints experience major destabilization. So in control groups, articular cartilage is almost completely lost. While in drug-treated, we see preservation of at least 90% of the tissue. And strikingly, in some animals, we see thicker articular cartilage than in non-operated joints. So it's not only slows down this drug, not only slows down degeneration, but it has this very strong anabolic effect that allows chondrocytes, basically cartilage cells, to deposit more matrix. And this is very impressive. There's nothing currently, even in experimental conditions, that can affect articular cartilage that way. And I think within 1 year, we should be able to start this this large animal trial. And it will take us approximately 1 year to finish it. So in 2 years, if everything goes according to our plan, we should be able to start phase one clinical trial with this new molecule.
I think it's interesting how many different factors are at play there. And it's viewed as just, one disease that affects in one way, but there are so many different factors there. So thinking about that a little bit more, so your research looks at stem cells. That's what you're using for the research and for the application. Is that correct? Or
Well, this is correct and incorrect.
So could you maybe...
We do have projects that involve stem cells.
Okay.
And we have projects that don't involve stem cells. And actually, this project that I'm telling you about, we think that this small molecule, this drug that we developed, it does not necessarily require stem cells to be involved. So we think what is going on in these joints, that the drug can stimulate proliferation of cartilage cells. So basically, these quiescent chondrocytes, they can go back into mitosis, especially in the injured region, and expand. This is something that is very difficult to achieve because the cells usually are very static. This drug returns them into more fetal-like stage because the way we discovered it, we went back into development and tried to understand how growing joints actually function in humans. We identified several critical mechanisms that make the cell so juvenile because, you know, in fetal development, synovial joints basically double in size every week. And they actually proliferate a lot. So you have at least 20 or 30% of the cells constantly proliferating in the fetus. In adult, you can hardly find a single cell that does that. And they go through the cycles of matrix remodeling. So they create some space for themselves because to proliferate and expand, they need to break down some matrix. But they do it in a highly orchestrated way. They break down, they expand, and then they regrow the matrix. And they do go through the cycles again and again. And that's how they can go from few millimeter size joint into 10 centimeter, 20 centimeter size. It's a billion-fold expansion. So we found that this mechanism can be reactivated in adult.
That's really fascinating. So basically reverting back to a much younger, I guess, cell type with the joint. So, you know, we're not talking necessarily the fountain of youth, but we're getting it to sort of act like a much younger joint than it may have previously been acting.
Yeah, that's correct. Yes.
Well, that's really exciting. So what do you think then is the future of joint replacement?
Well, I think, let me just mention briefly that we also have a project that is focused on pluripotent stem cell-derived chondrocytes. So our laboratory has developed a methodology where we can make cartilage cells or chondrocytes from stem cells in a highly efficient way in bioreactors. And we now scaled it up to a stage where we can produce billions of the cells. And at the moment, we have a large animal study where we're testing them, and they have quite significant potential, regenerative potential. Specifically, they can work for focal cartilage defects. They will not be able to slow degeneration. So these two approaches are completely different, right? When you have diffuse degeneration, those focal treatments are irrelevant. But sometimes patients start their osteoarthritis from one focal defect, focal lesion. So, and that's when we need this stem cell-derived cartilage cells or chondrocytes, when we can apply them and via minimally invasive procedure and heal this defect.
Yeah, because it sounds like what you're saying with the work with stem cells and the other molecule that you're creating, that almost they would work well in tandem together because they're sort of treating different parts of the osteoarthritis.
This is a complementary approach, and we feel that some patients will have these defects. You can't do anything. They'll present it right at the beginning. So you need a solution for focal cartilage defects.
That's really wonderful. So, you know, as I'm hearing it, you know, just to reiterate to everyone, it's that you've got sort of a widespread drug or molecule that can help regrow cartilage overall in the body, but you also come up with a way to use stem cells to repair very specific focal points, as you're saying. So
that's absolutely correct. Yes.
Great.
So your question about total joint replacement, right? Yeah, I think you know we need to be realistic. It will be very difficult to completely eliminate the need for this procedure, right? I think it will still be in place, but I think the main goal that we have here is to delay, right? To delay the and potentially in some people, yes, it may be complete elimination of the need for total joint replacement, because all these artificial joints, they only last for 15 years. So imagine if you need this total joint replacement at the age of 40, So it will be absolutely critical to do this revision surgery in 15 to 20 years, and some people may need it even earlier. It's fully invasive surgery with a lot of issues related to the general health, and if it can be avoided, especially this revision, it will be fantastic. And that's why we need to do the first surgery as late as possible. And I think this is clearly achievable. I don't think we will be able to completely cure osteoarthritis. So it's a disease of aging. People, you know, will have it, and more and more people have it. But I think we can delay the total joint replacement surgery maybe for 10, 15 years in patients, and it will be a major step forward.
Thank you for watching our discussion with Dr. Evseenko and learning about his work in stem cells and osteoarthritis. This month is Arthritis Awareness Month, so make sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel here and join the conversation on Instagram and Twitter by using the hashtag CureArthritis, and check out our website so that you can find ways to take action to cure arthritis.